What's up, gangsters? It's a fine day out here in the middle of nowhere at Rube Goldberg Laboratories, and I have decided to make a video to do some more testing. One of my favorite things, you guys know that. And this inevitably happens when I get frustrated because I can't figure out a technique, or I want to know for myself how a particular product works, or whatever the case may be. And this time, it's specifically about a technique. You may have seen in YouTube videos or in books some discussion of using watercolor pencils to do weathering. And it's pretty compelling. I mean, what could be more simple than just holding a pencil and drawing on your model? So it definitely sounds good when you say it fast. But in spite of plenty of discussion of it in books like this one, which is Diego Quijano's Aircraft Encyclopedia, specifically of the weathering volume of it, volume 4, where he talks extensively about using colored pencils, several guys that I know and myself have been trying it and just not had much success. And so we got into a discussion about it the other day on Scale Modelers Critique Group on Facebook, and it seems like there's definitely some differences in the types of pencils that you can buy, and that while watercolor pencils sounds pretty specific, it may not be quite that simple. So what I did is I went and looked at the pencils that I had, and now I'm not sure that they were the right ones. So I specifically went on Amazon and bought another set that I'm pretty sure are the right kind. And what I'm going to do is I've got a little bit of a canvas here. This is just a paint mule piece of plastic that has got nothing on it but Tamiya flat white that was thinned 50-50 with Mr. Leveling thinner. So what I have is a nice flat coat that should give me pretty good tooth for the pencil lead to grip on, because that is one thing that seems to be pretty consistent in most discussion, is that you need a matte surface, for the pencils to work well. So anyway, we've got the book, we've got some pencils, we've got a test subject, and we're gonna see if we can crack this nut. So let's get started. Okay, so first things first, let's talk about the pencils. What I've got here that I originally bought are these Prismacolor Premier. And what these things say on them is that they are a, soft, thick cores create smooth color laydown for superior blending and shading. And you can see the numbers here. These are all PC 924, 1008, whatever. All that's how these pencils are all coated. Okay, now when I originally bought that set, I thought they were watercolor pencils. I apparently am an idiot and wasn't paying very close attention, because then I came back a few days ago and looked again, and I bought this set, which also say Prismacolor Premier, but these specifically say that they are water soluble. And if you look on the back of this box, it says that these are, a harder lead, and these, you can see all of these color codes are WC whatever number. Now, part of the reason how I figured this out is I was looking on Amazon, and they have this handy dandy little chart that apparently I never saw the first time, and this tells you kind of what the breakdown is between each type of pencil they have and what they're supposed to be used for. And as you can see, they've got six different ones, and some of them have soft lead, some of them have hard lead, some of them are water soluble, some of them are not. Now, Verithin is a name that keeps coming up, and it's even in the book here. But if you'll notice here, it says Verithin are not water-soluble. And in the book, as you'll see, Diego talks about being able to use water to manipulate them in some of the techniques. So I went with these right here because they specifically say that they are water-soluble. That's this set that I got. So we're going to compare the differences between the two types of pencils and see what sort of different effects we get and how each of them works. One thing I should tell you that I thought was kind of cool, if you notice, this box has got some dents in it. I got this as an Amazon open box thing. How anybody even returns something like pencils is beyond me, because some of them in here are like half used. But I saved like a huge amount of money on these. This box of pencils is normally like $35 or $40, and I got them for $25. So just something to consider if you are looking for some of these, because even if they're a little bit used, there will be more than enough in there to satisfy probably what most of us will ever do. Now, I've also got here some other pencils that are talked about in this book, and that is I've got just a Prismacolor silver pencil for doing certain kinds of chipping, and we'll see how that works. And then I've got a couple of standard drafting pencils in two different hardnesses. I've got a 2B and a 4B, and we'll talk about those in a minute. So let's get into this book and take a look sort of at the first technique that we're going to try and duplicate and see how it goes. If I can manage to find the page that I've very cleverly marked with a Q-tip. Okay, so here we go. What we're looking at doing here is pencil chipping. And I'm not going to read all of the specific text, but basically, what we're looking to do is create small, discrete chips, like you can see in some of these pictures here, using the pencil lead. So that should be pretty straightforward. There's nothing in here that talks about anything other than just essentially using the pencil to draw on the surface. So let's check it out. Okay, here we go. So I've got some pencils here, nice and sharp. And what I've done is just picked some colors that'll be easy to keep track of. This purple one here is the Prismacolor watercolor, as you can see. So that should be a pretty hard lead. And then next to it, this green one is the softer core Prismacolor. And then I've got just the regular drawing pencils and the silver. So let's start with the silver one, because that's pretty normal for doing chips and scratches. And let's just see how we make do with that. Now, this specifically is the PC949 silver pencil, which was specifically recommended to me by several people. So, and I've used it before to what I would say are sort of, I don't know, semi-satisfying results. But I'm gonna just draw some chips here, and these aren't gonna be real good because I don't wanna take a lot of time. I just really want to evaluate how well the color gets deposited and how well it stays put. So don't immediately message me and tell me that my chips look stupid, because I know they do. Okay, so there you go. You can see what we've got going there. that's kind of what I'm going to do with each one of these. All right, it's kind of hard to see the silver on the white there, and but that has worked pretty well. Not too much to complain about there. Now, how color fast is it? Let's see what happens when I rub it with my finger. I'm just kind of rubbing it normally, and some of it's coming off. It's muted the effect a little bit, but it's pretty much stayed there, so that's a good thing. Now let's switch over to the drawing pencils. Now, this is a good place to just say real quickly, if you're not familiar with drafting pencils, or normal writing pencils, the way that these things are arranged in terms of hardness is the softest, I believe, is a 10B, and they go all the way up through 6B, 4B, 2B, to HB, which is right in the middle. And then you get into the harder varieties, which are 2H, 4H, 6H, etc. So what you can see with this 2B and this 4B are that I have a couple of fairly soft pencils. So we'll just see how each one of them behaves. Sorry, I keep bumping the camera. I'm trying to use my Optivisor to do this, but let's just see how what the difference is in the way each one behaves. So there's a few little scratches. Now, one thing that I would say for sure is, and hopefully you'll be able to see this here in a second, that was the 2B, and we're gonna go to an even softer one now, which is this 4B. One thing I would say is that you definitely want to have the sharpest point possible, especially for a softer lead, because you may not be able to see this because it's on camera, because it's kind of subtle, but even with this relatively smooth surface, it's got enough tooth to it that the very sharp point that I've put on these pencils already starts to get dull pretty quickly, and you can end up with marks that are pretty fat and not very crisp looking, and at a minimum are going to be probably out of scale. Like, for example, this wing is from a 1/48 scale kit, and so you just have to kind of watch out for that and make sure that you are keeping your pencils sharp. Now, you can probably instantly see that I was able to very quickly rub some of that off of there, but it still stayed fairly well. And I think you can see that we've got some decent chips. There's not a whole lot to say different about the two of them, except that the softer lead, the 4B, definitely smudged more easily, which is really no surprise, right? Okay, now let's get to what to me is the really interesting part of this, which is the watercolor pencils. Now, I'm going to start here with this green one. This is the one that I had before that does not, just never really worked very good for me. And I'm going to try to get on camera here. I tell you what, I'm going to change the angle of this stupid thing so that hopefully we are getting a better view without me constantly banging my head into it. And I'm also going to plug it in so that the battery doesn't die while I'm in the middle of trying to demonstrate. So, we'll see if this works a little bit better. All right, so here we go. Here is this green soft core pencil. Now, it seems to be coming off fairly well. Let's make some random scratch type marks. Okay, so that seemed to work pretty well, and you can see there what I've done. If the camera will decide to focus on this pure white thing. So, some intentional stuff and one not so intentional mark. So now I'm gonna rub on this one with my finger a little bit, and that's pretty color fast. It's not going anyplace. Certainly not like the graphite leads in the regular drawing pencils did. Okay, now this is going to be the purple color. Is going to be the actual watercolor pencil and a harder lead. And it definitely is. I mean, I can feel the difference as I'm drawing with it, that it's a harder lead. It just doesn't feel the same. It's making finer, more distinct marks, which I think is a good thing. But other than that, so far, there's not a whole lot to say that's different. So let's see how color fast that is, being that it is supposed to be a water soluble. Come on, camera, focus up there. There we go. So again, pretty terrible looking chips and scratches, but I'm rubbing that with my finger and it's staying put, as far as I can tell, just as well as the other one. So for this particular application, I can't see a huge difference in the way that any of the actual Prismacolor pencils perform. And the only difference really with the graphite is that they rub off easier, which is no surprise. So for the next test, what I'm going to do is go to a technique that Diego talks about in his book for creating streaks. So let's have a look at that. Actually, before we go to that, I almost forgot. One thing he talks about doing is, if you feel that the effect of the scratches that you've produced is too dramatic and you want to kind of tone it down, then what you do is come along with an eraser. And imagine that. Just erase them a little bit. And I'm doing that, and that, as should be no surprise to anyone, is pretty effective for doing exactly as advertised. You can see I've toned down the purple scratches there quite a bit. So I don't think we need to belabor that too much. Let's take a look at this next technique. Okay, so in this segment, the trick is really more about using graphite pencils to create streaks and smudges and wear on the edges of things like cockpit frames and some of the kind of chips we were just creating. So we've already seen some of that. So let's really focus on making smudges and streaks, because what he's talking about specifically here is to make the marks and then use a soft short bristled brush to do some blending. And the same thing with doing the streaks. So let's give it a try. Okay, Diego specifically recommends using the 4B pencil for this technique, so that's what I'm gonna do. But I think we could experiment with just about anything. But what I'm gonna do is just create some streaks going back from these rivets. And it would be a lot easier for me to draw straight lines if I wasn't bumping the camera into my pencil, but I'm not going to worry too much about the quality of my lines today. Now, so you can see what I'm doing there, and that's making some nice lines. It's harder than it looks, at least for me, to make them straight. You know, I'm sure you guys that are less clumsy will have better luck. I'm going to make some with the 2B as well, and you can immediately see the difference there. It's easier to make finer lines with the harder lead, which again should not be any surprise at all. So while we're at it, let's take, I think we already know that this is not gonna produce any sort of result, but let me just make a few streaks with this watercolor pencil. And let's see if we do any good there. I'll use both kinds just to make it a complete test. So there we go. We got a nice little lineup of very tiny streaks coming off of those rivets. And I've got a brush here. And this is a brush that I use a lot for chipping, and it looks to me like a pretty good approximation of what Diego has used in the book. So we'll see. And I'm just starting on the softest lead. And those streak pretty easily. They get muted down pretty easily with this brush. And then now just working along over these other harder leads and basically very little is happening. I'm getting a little bit of streaking movement on the harder graphite lead, but basically no effect on either of the two colored leads. But for the graphite, the effect is pretty nice. So, you know, there's some potential there. I just think it's a matter of picking the right pencil. But there you can kind of see now what they look like after working them over a little bit. So clearly that's a technique that takes the correct lead and a little bit of practice. Let's do now some smudging. And with this one, I'm going to just do one quickly with the 4B. And let's just pick a spot that might, I don't know, like this vent thing here and see if we can create a sort of a realistic looking streak that you might have coming off of this. So what I'm doing is I'm coloring it more heavily towards the front. And the pencils are a little less forgiving than you might expect. I mean, you can see where I wasn't being real precise that I got some stray marks kind of down inside that opening there. But I think we'll be able to see what we want to see here. So, using the brush with that, definitely does the trick. But you've got to be pretty precise in where you work, and so maybe a smaller brush would be better, because you can easily kind of start coloring outside the lines. So that gives you kind of an idea of how that streak sort of works. It's not too bad. Looking at it under my optivisor, I might choose to mute the front part of it a little bit, where maybe it's a little darker than I want. So let's see what happens when we use the pencil to kind of take away some of that drama. And of course, just like we saw before, that works pretty good. So You've got a lot of control. There's a pretty good representation of a sort of a smudge, streak, stain, whatever you want to call it, right there. And one of the things that Diego talks about is that this is low penalty, because if you screw up, you can remove it with water. So let's just try that. Let's just see what happens here. I'm going to just take and put a little bit of water right here on the bench. And I'm going to just, we'll just do this quick and dirty, see what happens. So I got a little rag here and just going to put some water on it. And let's see what we get. So I'm working on all of the marks that I've made here, and this is pretty interesting because pretty much the only one that is what I would call easily removable is the purple ones that were right there, which should be no surprise because the purple ink, which isn't completely gone, is, or not ink, but the purple lead is the water-soluble stuff. So you would pretty much expect that that's what would happen. And it's interesting because it does still show a little bit, and you might be able to use that to your advantage. So there we go. I think that's a pretty good sort of demonstration of that thing. Let's take a look at the third technique in the book. Okay, so here we go. This is where he's getting into what really kind of captured my interest about this technique, where he's used these colors to create this lovely stain, discoloration, scratch, chip pattern on the bottom of this drop tank. So what he's talking about here is using the pencils in two different ways. The first technique is to use the pencils dry, which is essentially what we just did, where we just use the pencils to make small marks and discolorations and then smudged them as best we could. So I don't think there's really much to be gained from doing that again. But what I think is going to prove to be the benefit of the watercolor pencils is where he talks about using water to blend them in. Now, in this particular case, you can see here on this mosquito wing, he's actually wetting the surface first and then creating the effect. So we're going to try that. Now, that specifically is going to be the watercolor pencil where we're going to try that. So I am going to actually get a brown one here. And I'm going to see if we can't do a reasonable job of sort of duplicating what Diego did in that section, but right here on top of this nacelle. Now, what he specifically says to do first is spray a little bit of water on the surface. So, as you can hear, I've got a little bit in my airbrush, and I'm just gonna, if I can get myself properly situated here. So, there we go. I don't know if that's the right amount or what, but we'll find out here in a second. So there's some water on that. And now let's go to work and see what we can do with this brown pencil. Now you guys are learning here right along with me. I have really no idea how I'm supposed to be doing this because I've never tried it before. So if this looks like ass, well, so be it. But you can definitely feel that the lead is being softened by the water that's on that surface there, which I assume is exactly what is supposed to happen. So that doesn't look great, but I think what we are supposed to do then is use a brush to do some blending. So I'm gonna get a smaller one. Got this old junky flexi-file brush, and I'm gonna just, and I haven't put any more water on it, but maybe I'm supposed to, because there's not a whole lot happening here. Pretty uneventful. Okay, so now this brush has some water on it, clearly. And I'm all but removing everything I just did, so I think what I'm gonna do is get another little bit of water here and go back to this smaller brush and see if I can't control this a little bit better. You know, some of this is just going to come down to your artistic talent, and so if you basically are like me and don't have any, then you may be just SOL on techniques like this, but we'll see what we can do. What I find with a lot of this stuff is that it really does come down to the minutiae of the technique that you're using. And some of it is really subtle and hard to decode. I know that's how it was for me, and still is really, with chipping. And I end up almost feeling like I'm starting over every time I do it. So, anyway, that's you can see, manipulated a little bit with some water. Now, what I want to figure out is, how do I blend that in? How do I make that look more like a smudge, like we saw in the picture in the book? So I'm going to come back with this brush is dry again, and just kind of trying to rub on there, and you can see nothing much really is happening there. I think that what this amounts to is that this is basically like watercolor paint that we've applied to that surface. I mean, even when I get after it with my finger, you can see not a whole lot happening there. It's not really going anyplace. So let's see what happens when we use an eraser on it and see if we can sort of work that into a more attractive looking stain there. You can see that, again, not a whole lot is happening. They're definitely having some effect, but it's still not really looking much like what we're seeing in the pages of the book. So this clearly is a technique that is going to require more practice. I mean, I don't think that it looks, I don't think it looks terrible. Let me look at it under my, I don't think it looks terrible, but it doesn't have soft blended edges like I think we want. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to turn the camera off for a minute and just tinker with this and see what I can do. I'll be back in a second. Okay, so I've been tinkering with this for 15 or 20 minutes, and I have a result that doesn't look much like what we saw in the book. But one thing that you read in the fine print is that to get that specific look that he got, Diego had airbrushed some brown tones into that area on that drop tank before he worked with the pencils. So you can see that there. What I was hoping is that we could achieve that sort of pastel blending effect with the pencils, but that doesn't really seem to be the case. And it's no surprise that that sort of smooth shading took an airbrush. What I found when I was working with this is that it really is all about how you do the blending, and because you're working with watercolor paints on a permeable surface, that they tend to kind of soak in and they don't blend the way that oils do, for example. And in fact, I think I could probably have done what I wanted to do from the very beginning with oils much easier. But that's not to say that this was an ineffective technique. I did tinker around with blending it in some different ways using a damp paintbrush. I even came back with a little piece of steel wool and kind of scrubbed that off a little bit. I also tried the other pencils, which are supposed to be better for shading. And what you find, or what I found anyway, with this softer lead was that it just, in some places it sticks pretty well, and in other places it doesn't. And so that's kind of, I think, the frustration that I had been finding before was that I just couldn't get consistent action out of it, where it left enough material on the surface for me to feel like I was doing any good. But you can see right there, I created a streak and smudged it just a little bit. And, you know, then I can take a piece of steel wool and kind of feather that out a little bit. So again, I think that what all of this really comes down to is that this is really a lot like working with oils. There's a lot you can do, and how successful you are at getting there is going to really depend on the real subtle details of your technique, and that a lot of it is going to come down to blending. I mean, you can see what I've done there. It's not an implausible or unrealistic discoloration. There's pretty nice tonal variation there, but I sort of feel like it was a failure because I didn't get exactly what I was after. So you just have to decide, what you think, how this technique might work for you. But regardless, it's going to take some practice and some work. Okay, so it's next morning, and I have to confess that after I finished doing what I showed you yesterday, I was a little frustrated for two reasons. One is that I just didn't feel like I was doing a very effective job of kind of showing you what these things can do, but also I wasn't really reaching any good conclusions, and I sort of felt like I was wasting everybody's time. And maybe I still am, but I went away and did some more work, and I've got a slightly different view to today. One of the reasons that I was frustrated is because myself and Matt McDougall and Jimmy D have all got the common complaint that we can't seem to get the pencil to make any effective marks on the material. And I was a little confused yesterday because with both of the types that I have, the soft core and the hard core, I didn't have any trouble making marks. There's the soft core. Looks like it's marking pretty effectively to me. And then here's the harder lead. Same thing. And I was kind of scratching my head thinking, okay, well, what the heck? Am I just crazy? I mean, we know that's mostly true, but then I did a little bit of blending with some steel wool, and I kind of discovered what I think is really the thing with these softer leaded pencils. If there is any increase in the sheen of your surface at all, the softer leads are just not going to work. And let me demonstrate that. You saw right there where I made the marks with both of them. Now, watch what happens. If I take this piece of steel wool here, okay, and let me just go right next to that. I'm going to just scrub that a little bit. Make that a little, you know, it's not going to be a mirror polish. Well, it might be according to what some people think a mirror polish is, but anyway, now you can see there's a slight sheen there. Now, let's come back with the hard pencil and let's make some marks. And you can see it's still making a mark, but not nearly as effectively. I mean, it's I'm kind of scrubbing there, and what's happening is that it's not really creating a deposit of color as much as it is just kind of flaking off the tip of the pencil lead. Now, if I grab the softer one and do the same thing, same deal, and really even worse. So you can see what the problem is there. There's just no tooth. There's nothing happening on that surface that allows the tip of the pencil to be ground off as it passes over it. And that's basically how a pencil works. So here's the thing, I think. This is Tamiya flat white. Okay, it's XF2. And it has a microscopically rough surface. We all know that that's the way matte paints work. So if you're using a paint that's got, a semi-gloss to it, in particular, things like Mr. Paint lacquers, for example, Guns lacquers, then you probably have a slightly shinier surface. And maybe even, you know, if you've used a semi-gloss varnish, for example. So I think that there's a difference that probably appears to be pretty subtle. You may look at it from a couple feet away and say, oh, these two surfaces are of equivalent flatness, if you will. But when you get down to a microscopic texture level, one of them is slightly smoother, and it's enough to cause that pencil to not work effectively. So I think that kind of helps me at least feel like I've sort of learned something. Now, given that, what I ended up doing was just really focusing on these harder lead pencils. And by kind of just goofing around with, using different shades and using some water and doing some blending in different ways with little brushes. I did some blending with this little thing that I also use for chipping a lot. I was able to achieve, what I think is a pretty nice kind of dirty stain right there and some streaks on some of these areas that I feel pretty good about. But I also did some of these with graphite pencil, and I thought that worked really well for this type of streaking because it was nicely controllable. I also found that, you know, using different things to do blending, a Q-tip, a dry Q-tip works pretty nicely and is pretty controllable. But then I got into a little bit of a brainstorm, and I thought, I wonder what kind of color variations I could introduce on an entire panel with these things. And that's what I did here. And I'm going to show you how I did that. I think that's a pretty interesting effect right there, because you get some nice blotchiness. I also did it over here, and it's much more dramatic, and it kind of still looks like pencil work. But this was just to really illustrate the degree of tonal variation that you could get with this method. So here's what I did. Let me just take let me find an interesting color. How about this green one? And keep in mind that, you know, on white, this is going to show up a lot. Okay, that one went on the floor, so we're not going to use that. This is going to show up a lot on white, but just imagine that you were doing this, like this one, for example, over a base color of, olive drab or something. So what I did is I just started shading. And for that, you know, I wanted a fairly dull pencil so that I got nice broad strokes. You can do it in varying amounts. What I did with this blue one is I masked it off and shaded in the whole panel. But I went darker in some areas than others, which is easy to do. You just kind of keep scrubbing and get a little darker and deposit more of the lead on there. You can go just in the direction of airflow if that sort of logic appeals to you. But you see what I'm getting at here. I'm just shading over a larger area, and it doesn't have to be. I mean, you could do smaller areas too. But you're about to see where this gets interesting, in my opinion. What I did then is I just took a little bit of water and a little sponge, because I did this with the brush as well. And the brushes work, but it didn't give me quite the blotchy effect that I'm always after. So what I do is I get the sponge wet, and I try and get rid of most of the water. So I'm just kind of unloading it on my sleeve here, and now I've got just a little bit, and now I'm gonna just start blotching and dabbing in that area. And what happens is an effect that is very similar to what you see when you have an area that's been blended with oil paint, and you come back with a sponge that is slightly moistened with mineral spirits. And you can kind of produce this real blotchy tonal variation. So you can see what's going on there. Let me give you a closer look. I'll blow this, get this dried a little bit so you can see better what's going on here. Okay, so there you go. That's what happens. But basically what's happening with this watercolor pencil is that when you introduce the water, you're essentially turning it into watercolor paint. And depending on the substrate, it's going to soak into the surface more or less, depending on how permeable that surface is. With a totally matte paint like this XF2, it tends to soak in more, obviously. But you can see it creates interesting and very natural and random patterns. And I think that's kind of a compelling principle. It presents some compelling possibilities for weathering your paint and introducing paint wear. Now, here's kind of the cool thing. Let's say you just really don't like what you did there. So before you commit to sealing it in with any kind of a clear coat, you can just take a wet towel and you can get rid of most of it. Now, how much of it you're going to get rid of will depend, like I said, on the permeability of the paint that you were working on top of and how much that watercolor has soaked into it. You can see I just wiped off most of that blue, but that's it. That's all that's coming off. So you might even at that point feel like, okay, that's stable enough that you almost don't even need to seal it in with any varnish. And to me now that looks even, you know, almost even more interesting and natural. So, there's definitely some things there to consider that you might be able to accomplish with these pencils. Okay, so there you go. I hope you guys felt like that was worthwhile. This was just one of those things that's been frustrating me, and I really wanted to try and crack the code. And I feel like I definitely have a better understanding of this material and this technique now. So what are my ultimate conclusions about using pencils, watercolor pencils, as a weathering method? At this point, here's what I would say. First of all, you really have to pay attention to which ones you buy. As you saw from this chart, even with Prismacolor, saying, oh, I got the Prismacolor pencils, is kind of like saying, oh, I bought Tester's paint. Okay, well, which one? Because obviously there are some differences. I thought it was interesting that even though in Diego's book he talks about using the Varathin pencils, it says on this piece of paper that Varathin is not water soluble. And he specifically talks about using them as watercolor pencils. And several people I know have bought the Varathin pencils and found that you can work them with water. So I don't know what the ultimate answer to that is. I just would say pay attention, if you're purchasing some. There are obviously other brands of these pencils like Faber-Castell and others. And that also brings up another point. I feel like that the soft core pencils, probably not so much use because they really only work well on a super flat surface and they don't smudge. If you're looking to do a type of a pigment effect where you fade it out like I was doing on some of those streaks, then I don't think they're going to be that effective. If all you want to do is create little chips and scratches, then the soft core pencils probably would work fine. But for my money, I would buy the hard lead pencils because you can do both things with those. Plus, you've got the versatility of being able to work it with water in different ways. The bummer is that at least with Prismacolor, the soft core pencils have 150 total available colors and the Prismacolor Premier Watercolor only 36. And that brings up something else, about the value of this. This box of 36 that I got only has about 12 colors that I'll really ever use. There's a lot of pinks and greens and purples and things in there that are, just really fruity and not applicable to what most of us do. There may be other brands that have sets that are more tailored to earth tones or something like that. I don't know. But here to me is kind of the key question. Would I do this instead of what I've been doing using oils and enamels? And I would say that the answer is a definite maybe, but probably not. I think you saw from what I showed there that I really didn't accomplish anything that I could not have done using an oil-based system. And I classify oils and enamels as basically the same thing. And so if I were already invested in that method, I don't think I would run out and spend the money on these pencils just to be able to do mostly the same thing. Especially when it comes to, you know, really effective blending and things like that. But there are a couple of things where I feel like the pencils have a little bit of an advantage. Now, one is obviously really tiny stuff, where you just need that super sharp point that's difficult to achieve using a brush. And little scratches and things like that might be one of those things. I personally found that for creating little very tiny streaks that were all real uniform and straight, like you might find coming off of rivet heads, that the pencils worked probably better for me than a paintbrush does. And so that's probably going to be my tool of choice for that type of thing when I want to do that. The other thing that I thought was interesting that I may find myself trying is this sort of overall panel shading and creating tonal variation. Maybe not for an entire airframe, but maybe for select panels I might choose this technique. Because while it does produce basically the same effect as working with oils, what I don't have to do is get the oils out, squeeze them out onto a piece of cardboard so that they can leach for half an hour, and, you know, then give them a day or so of drying time before I can do anything else. That's an advantage. I also kind of liked the controllability with the wet sponge. It's one of those things where you really have to sort of figure out the subtleties and the nuances of it, but it does seem to be, for me anyway, maybe a little easier to control to the specific effect that I'm after than oils do. But I'm not an expert with oils. I'm very early in the learning curve on those things as well, so who knows. But anyway, that's kind of my view on this technique now, and I'm kind of glad that I did this, that I spent the money, got the pencils, and spent the time to get into it, because I just really hate feeling like there's a technique out there that so many people feel is amazeballs that I just can't get the hang of. While I don't feel like I'm an expert with pencil weathering now, I do feel at least a little bit better about it. And maybe this information has helped you guys as well. So, there you have it. As always, I appreciate you watching. Take care. Much love.